So I think it's completely non-news just to visit the MIDO observatories. You have already seen the essential. But this is the fifth anniversary of the operation of the MIDO Atmospheric Observatory. And it will be a talk with four voices, myself and three colleagues that are hidden there here. And so this is the plan. We'll have a general overview of the MIDO Observatory, the scientific and the regional context, example of scientific results, and then summary and future direction. So the a brief bit of history to explain why France has such a large observatory over Réunion Island. I think it begins with the France commitment to operate instrumented experimental sites to survey the climate at different latitudes. And and the network NDAC was, in fact, the first motivation to this, to detect the atmospheric composition change. So you see the observatory at Haute-Provence. Observatories in the South Pole, but and in MIDO. So why we select La Réunion? There are, of course, several criteria. The location is the first one, to be in the southern hemisphere tropics. Also to have a high altitude site on the leeward side of the Iceland for the LIDAR. Science, to develop some collaboration between local people at the university and the main research organism mainland in France. The political dimension, the stability of overseas Department of France. And the last one is the key, the funds, to have the key to build research infrastructure on climate. So this is the time frame, starting from 1993 with the research laboratory at the university, the name of which was LPA. Then the LACI, where the French organism come, CNRS and Météo France. Then we build the OSUR, which is a kind of overall structure and a federative structure. And the European and regional and government fund by the FIDER in 2010 to build the observatory, and then five years of operation. So what are our objectives? The first one is to build a long-term series of essential climate variables in our latitude band. And you know that we have to meet the standard for large international research network and European infrastructure. It's not useless to only to measure. We have to provide the quality of our measurements, the precision. And this is a big part of the job. And we have also to be open data access for the observation. We have also to participate to satellite validation and calibration. At the moment, we are participating to two. One is the wind LIDAR on board ADM Aeolus. And the other one is about clouds and aerosol. We want to conduct research on climate and regional scale processes. So it first for the international research, and as an example, it could be the impact of trace gases on, in the tropopause region on surface climate. But we have also to follow the strategy, the local strategy, the what we name here the S3 strategy, to be interested in regional context, and one of the regional contexts is, of course, natural risk due to volcano and due to cyclone. And there will be two talks after to speak about this. And then we want to promote transnational access to research scientists to foster the scientific collaboration, but also to support operational cost of the observatory. So this is a list of what is composed our observing system. So we have LIDAR, you have seen, the laser room at the observatory, the telescope room, the laser beam in the sky. And some example, so on the left you have a temperature profile up to 90 kilometers with a mesospheric inversion. And Alain also show you some comparison between the profile, of wind profile from the our LiDAR to compare to the ICMWF data. We have also water vapor LiDAR, and you see here a time series of water vapor profile from 4 to 20 kilometers. So this LiDAR now are in the NDAC network, and we try to put some of them in the ACTRIS network too. And I'm moving to the passive remote sensing, where we have a spectrometer, radiometer, and photometers with observing different variables and trace gases. And you have here an example of an infrared spectrometer looking at the sun. And this is the spectrometer inside the building. And you have a time series here of ozone depleting substances like CFC-11 and CFC-12. You can see the stability of the concentration over time. And this one is HCFC-22. And you can see an increase. And so this is a collaboration with EASB, the Belgium Aerospace Institute. And we have a collaboration with them since 2002. All this instrumentation is labeled in different network, ACTRIS, NDAC, TICON, or AeroNet. Moving to in-situ measurements, where the aerosol and the trace gases are observed, either reactive or greenhouse gases. This is an example of greenhouse gases, measurement at the surface with a Picaro instrumentation. So it gives you the time series of CO2, the time series of methane, and CO. And the labelization in ACTRIS, GO, WMO, or ICOS. And there are other instrumentation like the radio sounding for ozone in labeled in shadows, and many other instruments. I couldn't name them, all of them. So I will give the floor to Valentin for the scientific and regional context.
Thank you, Jean-Pierre. Hello. So I will present you the scientific and regional context, which should answer the question. So we have a great observatory, but why is it in Réunion Island, and why is it at the Maïdo Mount? Merci. This is for the tonight's talk, so I won't talk about the atmospheric structure, neither that, and, well, I can talk about that. So if you have a look on the maps of the GO stations and of the INDAC stations, you can see that most observatories are in the northern hemisphere, and very few of them in the southern hemisphere, especially in the southwest Indian Ocean. So we are very well located to study several kind of processes. I will go from the UTLS down to the boundary layer to justify the location of this observatory. So this is quite a dense slide. What you have to the main part is that the chemical constituents enter the stratosphere through the UTLS region, especially in the tropical tropopause layer. And for this reason, Réunion Island is an ideal place to study what happens in the UTLS for several kinds of constituents: H2O, aerosols for cirrus formations, halogens, and of course ozone. So several kinds of phenomena can occur. We have deep convection that can bring constituents from the boundary layer up to the UTLS and ultimately in the stratosphere. We have cyclones that can trigger deep convection, and also volcanic eruption and biomass burning. We will talk about that a little bit more afterwards. Please note also the subtropical jet, which can disturb the tropopause region and cause some stratosphere to troposphere exchange. Yes, and once in the stratosphere, the constituents are spread towards the pole thanks to the Brewer-Dobson circulation. Going further down, in the free troposphere, you have here the main transport pathways of air masses impacted the pre-troposphere above Réunion Island. You can see that air masses coming from South America, Southern Africa, and also Southeast Asia, when the Asian monsoon anticyclone is set up in July and August and creates dynamical conditions that enable this pathway. So we are impacted by a lot of regions, and those regions are, you may know, in a demographic, economic, and also deforestation frenzy. You may have already seen this animation. This is a GEOS 5 animation from the NASA. This is the aerosols. In orange, you have the dust. In white, you have the sulfate from the anthropogenic activities. In blue, you have the marine aerosols. And in green, the biomass burning aerosols. It starts in, we are now in September 2006, so in the middle of the biomass burning season of the Southern Hemisphere. And you can see that Réunion Island is impacted by what's coming from Southern Africa and South America. I will illustrate what we can see regarding this biomass burning season afterwards. Going further down in the boundary layer, I will answer the question, so why at the Maïdo Observatory? Well, at night, in the Maïdo Observatory, we are in the free troposphere most of the time. And during the daytime, we are in the boundary layer, meaning that for during the nighttime, we can measure with our in-situ measurements the atmospheric composition relative to the surrounding area, the regional area, Southwest Indian Ocean. Yes. And during the daytime, you have here the main flow, those are trade winds coming from the southeast, splitting in two around the island, with a return flow here on the northwest coast, and the Maïdo is here. So from the shore up to the Maïdo Mount, we have a natural laboratory to study what happens to the air masses coming from the ocean, loaded in sea salts, passing above the forests, getting loaded in gases emitted by the forest, which can form ultimately secondary organic aerosols, and interacting with clouds. Actually, we have a daily life cycle of clouds at the Maïdo. The clouds form around noon and vanish by the end of the day. We are going to show you some quick examples of scientific results illustrating what I just told you. So here you have a plot from a recently published paper from one of our PhD students, Brice Foucard, showing the nucleation of aerosols. So you have on the y-axis the size of aerosols, and here the time, and the color shows the concentration. We go from 1 nanometer up to 700 nanometers. And here you have an animation of a typical day of the clouds forming and vanishing by the end of the day. So what we can see here is that the aerosols nucleates, well, form and grow during the day, and so it's in UTC. So at 4 UTC, it's a sun rise, and here this is a sunset. So this is a typical day of what happens at the Maïdo Observatory. Going further up in the free troposphere, I just told you that we were impacted by air masses coming from different areas where biomass burning season, when biomass burning occurs. So you have here three climatologies for aerosol optical depths. Here you have ozone profiles measured by ECC sounds, and here carbon monoxide total column measured by FTIR. So you can see on these three climatologies that there are a clear peak in October, which is in the middle of the Southern Hemisphere biomass burning season. So now Stéphanie is going to focus on the H2O in the UTLS. Stéphanie, please.
So as Valentin mentioned, the UTLS region, which is shown here in this, the blue shaded area corresponds to the gate to the stratosphere, which means that every tropospheric constituents coming from the lower altitude in the tropics are going to enter the stratosphere by this region. And in particular, we are interested in water vapor in this region and in the stratosphere, because we know that UTLS and stratospheric water vapor has an impact on the surface climate. So in quantity, it's relatively low in the stratosphere. It's about 5 out of 1 million particles in the stratosphere, but it has an impact on surface climate via its impact on the radiative balance of the atmosphere of the Earth. It can impact also stratospheric ozone chemistry. And a recent study has also shown that changes in stratospheric water vapor can influence atmospheric circulation, and especially the position of tropospheric jet streams. So this figure at the top here is from a study by Susan Salomon in 2010, showing what the change of stratospheric water vapor, what is the effect on decadal trend of surface temperature. And what she showed in that study is that increase or decrease of stratospheric water vapor will have an impact on the surface global warming. It can either amplify or reduce it. But at the moment, most climate models have still difficulties to represent stratospheric water vapor and the subsequent impact on surface climate because of a misrepresentation of processes happening in the UTLS and in the troposphere as well. So this is an example from satellite observation to show you how the stratospheric water vapor is changing during the year. So here you have months and latitudes. And this is showing the evolution of water vapor in the lower stratosphere. And you will notice that as we go toward our austral summer to our austral winter, we're going to have an increase of water vapor. And so this contrast between austral summer and austral winter is due to the change in the temperature of the tropopause, which is going to set the entry value of water vapor in the stratosphere. So at MIDO, we have different ways to observe UTLS water vapor. One of them is the LIDAR that was presented in the Morgan video. Another way is a radio sound instrument, which is called the CFH. So we try to organize campaign where we coordinate balloon launch with CFH and LIDAR measurements. And so this is here a list of all these campaigns. Most of them took place as part of the transnational access program of ACTRIS. And here, just you can see here all the profiles that have been obtained from this campaign. And what I like about this plot is how here you see the concentration of water vapor as a function of altitude. And you go here from the troposphere, where you have a lot of variability, to the stratosphere, where all the values are. You have less variability. And you see that everything is set by this region. So it's very important to be able to measure this region. So this region is going to be under the influence of different processes depending on summer or winter. But one thing which is important in summertime is convection. And we try to launch these sounds on an alert event where we use a forecasting tool to monitor where we are going to have interesting cases to observe UTLS water vapor and other gases such as ozone. And so here we have an example of the measurements that we took, that we made in March of this year to sample the convective outflow from the tropical cyclone Enao. And so here you see the water vapor profile here in black and the ozone. And you know that when you have a low ozone concentration with high water vapor, this is a signature of convective outflow. So in the next 3 years, we're going to continue this type of measurements in coordination with LIDAR as part of a project that was funded by ENA, which is the French National Research Agency. The project is called Concerto. It's going to focus on understanding processes of happening in the UTLS region and affecting water vapor. The scientific objectives are listed here. But one thing which is important in this campaign is that we're going to have a cloud radar from the University of Leeds, which is going to come in Austral summer 2018. And it will also benefit another campaign focusing on tropical cyclone as part of a rain of risk project, which is going to be presented by Cartulet this afternoon. So now we're going to focus on another aspect of one process that can influence UTLS, and for that, I will let Hélène speak.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Stéphanie. We will now focus on stratospheric intrusions. We can difficultly speak about stratosphere to troposphere exchanges without talking about jet streams or even Rossby wave breakings that were supposed to be here on the video. So some strong wind circulation all around the globe are undulating, sometimes combining and even splitting. And the Southwest Indian Ocean is influenced by both the tropical and sometimes polar jet streams. In case of Rossby wave breakings, some stratospheric air will penetrate into the troposphere, bringing high amount of ozone. So it is important to understand those dynamical processes because they could impact the tropospheric ozone budget. That's why I want to show you the results of the case study on the 4th of April 2013 above Réunion Island. Here are the observations of the Meidu Observatory. On the left, it's ozone LiDAR profile, and on the right, it's water vapor radio soundings and LiDAR profiles. What you can see in red is three maxima of ozone correlated with a very dry layer. It corresponds to stratospheric features. So the data of the Meidu Observatory were able to detect stratospheric intrusion events. But it was not a simple one. It was not only one maximum of ozone. It's three different peaks of ozone associated with relative minima and very dry layer. So the situation must be quite complex. It was a good data set to characterize the importance of subtropical stratosphere-troposphere exchanges on the calculation of the tropospheric ozone budget. For that, we've used different tools, global analyses of simultaneous observations of ozone and water vapor, and Eulerian and Lagrangian models. What have we learned? Thanks to Lacitrage, a Lagrangian model, we are able to trace back the story of air masses. If you know where were the air masses on April 4 above Réunion Island, you can use this model and trace these back trajectories to know where were the particles a few days before. Here in purple and in pink were two different air masses superimposed with wind fields. And what you can see on the left part of the figure is that at the end of March, both air masses were influenced by different jet streams. So it was a complicated dynamical situation, but not less representative of the Southwest Indian Ocean. So with such dynamical processes, would the models be able to reproduce correctly this intrusion? The results are on the right part, with two different models, Lacitrage at the top and Mesoenache in the bottom. You can see northern cross-section at the longitude of Réunion Island, and in white, where the LiDAR profile would be located. What you can see is the deep stratospheric reservoir penetrating into the troposphere up to 11 kilometers, and then a mixing of tropospheric and stratospheric layers with isolated stratospheric air, which means that there were some irreversible exchanges, so an impact on the ozone budget. Results of these papers show us that the data of the Meidu Observatory were very interesting in multi-tracer approach of STE. Why? Because the LiDARs of the Meidu Observatory are not only locating in the same room, they're operating at the same time. So it's real collocated and simultaneous measurements. Then, we've seen that even such a complex dynamical situation, both models were suitable to interpret STE processes. And the irreversibility of the exchanges shown by the back trajectories supports the conclusion that STE processes are important on the subtropical tropospheric ozone budget, which will be linked to the variability of a greenhouse case. So in the future, we will systemize and extend the multi-tracer approach of STE with all the database of the Meidu Observatory. And now that we know that the models are suitable, we will quantify the impact of such events on tropospheric ozone budget at regional and local scales. So now we will see other results. Let's go back to the dynamical situation of the southern hemisphere, and we'll talk about long-range transport of volcanic aerosols.
So unfortunately, we were a bit ambitious on the talk, and so I will have to skip some slides, which were from Nelson Begg. I'm sorry for him. It was about the Calbuco eruption over South America and evidence of this eruption in the stratosphere over La Réunion, but we don't have the time to show this, sorry. I'm going right to the conclusion. So we have some numbers to show after 5 years of operation about the data we are providing to labeled network and research infrastructure. There is also papers in peer review journals that have been published, campaigns and transnational access days we have provided, like through ACTRIS 2 and ANVRI Plus. We address various topical issues for the atmosphere and its interfaces. There are interdisciplinary work done at the MIDO. And we have the ambition to be an advanced sentinel of the climate change in the region. So the outlook is that, it's to answer a question by Paolo, we will submit our Go Global Station application in a few weeks or before the end of the year. For sure. We are working for to enter into the ACTRIS transnational ACTRIS program and to become a national facility. And also there is a big work to do about the GCOS reference upper air network, about water vapor with all the instrumentation we have, with radio sondes, LIDAR. We also want to enter into this network. So thank you for this.